Mehul Choksi, the fugitive India is trying to get back to justice, maybe one step closer to actually coming back to the country. Just as India's law was closing in on the 69-year-old jeweler, if you remember, he and his nephew, Nirav Modi, disappeared after cheating Punjab National Bank of 13,000 crores. Choksi, in fact, bought his citizenship in the tiny island nation of Antigua in the West Indies for a little less than a crore of rupees. Well, now Antigua's Prime Minister has said his citizenship will be revoked in a course of time, as long as he's sort of once he's exhausted all his legal options, suggesting that it is actually just a matter of time before his extradition process can begin. The government at this point is reacting with caution. We asked tonight, should this be seen as a big diplomatic victory for India? Let's take you through that report first.
Fugitive diamond trader Mehul Choksi, wanted in India in the 13,500 crore Punjab National Bank scam, will soon lose his Antiguan citizenship, a big step towards his extradition that India has been pushing for. The Antigua Observer has quoted Prime Minister Gaston Browne as saying that the reality is his citizenship will be revoked and he will be repatriated to India. We're not trying to provide any safe harbour for those involved in financial crimes. Criminals have fundamental rights too. Choksi has a right to go to court and defend his position. But I can assure you, after he has exhausted all of his legal options, he will be extradited. India filed its extradition request in August last year.
Diplomatic sources told NDTV that they have not received any official communication from government of Antigua regarding extradition proceedings which are going on there. However, the statement made by their Prime Minister will also not have any bearing on the court proceedings which are taking place in Antigua. Extradition request of Ministry of External Affairs is broadly based on two points. First is principle of reciprocity and second is dual criminality.
Mehul Choksi is also fighting a case in the Bombay High Court, which he has moved to quash the Enforcement Directorate's plea to declare him a fugitive economic offender and cited ill health as a reason for not being able to return to India to join the probe here. The court has now asked Choksi's lawyers to submit his latest health reports by Monday and ordered that a copy be given to doctors at JJ Hospital. The panel of doctors at JJ Hospital will submit their report in a sealed envelope to the Bombay High Court, based on which the court will pass orders on the 10th of July. The Enforcement Directorate has also informed the court that just in case it's required, they're willing to arrange for an air ambulance to get Mehul Choksi back so that he faces trial right here in India. The massive PNB scam came to limelight when the bank moved the CBI for a probe in February 2018. Along with Mehul Choksi, his nephew Nirav Modi has also been named as an accused. Nirav Modi is facing extradition proceedings in the same case in the United Kingdom.
Sources in the Central Bureau of Investigation and Enforcement Directorate have told NDTV that they have provided all the case-related documents against Mehul Choksi to the Antigua government through Ministry of External Affairs. And the Antigua Prime Minister calling Mehul Choksi as a criminal is indeed a victory for them. They also add, unlike Vijay Mallya and Nirav Modi case, the Antigua judicial system is not so complicated and they are very hopeful that Mehul Choksi will be extradited very soon. With Saurav Gupta and Neeta Sharma, Aravind for NDTV.
All right, what does this mean at this point? Is this really a shot in the arm for the investigating agencies who are trying to get him back? What does this mean in terms of a victory for India diplomatically? Is it indeed that there has, remember, been no official announcement yet? And India, for the moment at least, is reacting cautiously. Let's take this across to our panel tonight. Biswajit Bhattacharya, former Additional Solicitor General, joining us on the program. Vivek Reddy, lawyer and leader of the BJP, is with us. Atul Verma, who is formerly in the Enforcement Directorate and currently serving ADGP in Himachal Pradesh, is with us tonight. And we are also expecting to be joined by Shailbir Panag, international law expert, who's also been following Mehul Choksi's case closely. But Vivek Reddy, let me begin with you. We heard the foreign minister today say there's been no official announcement from Antigua. he was very cautious. Sources indicating also at this point that, until we hear officially from Antigua, they're not going to sort of celebrate. But how should we see this development? For the first time, you have the Prime Minister of Antigua, which gave citizenship or rather sold citizenship to Mr. Mehul Choksi, admitting that he is a criminal and that once he has exhausted his legal recourse, he is going to be extradited. Or rather, at least his citizenship is going to be revoked.
Yes, I think, Ankita, it is a big, big diplomatic victory for the government of India and for the people of India, first of all. Secondly, the fact that this recognition comes from the person no less than the Prime Minister of Antigua is what is most significant here. Because the political leaders of these nations are aware that Mr. Choksi is there with the criminal loot of Indian money and that he is a criminal. So this adds to the whole effort by India.
But Vivek Reddy, it's important that you bring up the money.
And the only thing that it has to go through.
It's important that you bring up the subject of money.
Yes, apparently.
Yes, because 13,000 crores that Mehul Choksi and his nephew Nirav Modi have defrauded India of. Even if his citizenship in Antigua is revoked, even if the extradition process happens, what happens to that money? How do we get the money back? Isn't that the crux of this particular situation?
Well, the ED is out there. The ED is out there trying to recover and trace the sources of money. Some of the money, at least some of it, they have seized. They have seized paintings. They have seized several precious items. And this is being reported to the court. Apart from this,
but Vivek Reddy, surely even you would agree that is literally a drop in the ocean.
Able to get the fuller story.
We're talking about 13,000 crore rupees, which have gone missing in a flash.
Correct.
A few paintings. Ankita, that is why we want
Mr. Choksi in India. You're right. We have declared him a fugitive of economic offender. Once he is back in India, we will be able to trace his sources, both Indian and foreign. And we will be able to retrieve the money. And that's the whole object of the law. The Fugitive Offenders Bill, which says that even if the money, Indian money, is traced to foreign countries, you could still recover them. So that is
Atul
the point
Varma,
here.
Come in on this.
And this is one step in that process.
Okay, and one step in the process. One step in the process. Vivek Reddy believes that this is going to lead us.
And make him
this is going to lead us to
that's
the money. Atul Varma, is it as simple as that?
Very good development.
Honestly, whether we have an economic offenders bill or not, given the nature of these digital transactions, where literally in the press of a button, there is money being wired from one country to the other, a trail that no one has been able to track down so far. What is this going to mean in terms of getting to the money, even if we actually get Nirav Modi back, Mehul Choksi back to India, what happens to the money? Because at the end of the day, 13,000 crores of public money literally has vanished.
It's obviously a long drawn process, but this is a big step in that direction. As far as the PMLA, Prevention of Money Laundering Act, is concerned, which the ED administers, there are two aspects of it. One is attachment of property. Mm-hmm. The other one is criminal prosecution.
Right.
So, and both of them will help each other. As far as criminal prosecution is concerned, you have to get the person here. Mm-hmm. And only then can he be prosecuted properly and you can expect him to undergo a jail term. Once he's brought here, once there is a custodial interrogation, mm-hmm. which possibly would happen after he comes here, you expect more information which can lead to attachment of his properties. Of course, it's a painstaking investigation. Money may have been converted, may have been taken out in various countries, may have been rotated throughout the world, converted into different types of assets. But then this is definitely...
But may I just put it to you at this point that the Enforcement Directorate's own rate of conviction under the PMLA law, even after 15 years, is barely in double digits. Why is there such a poor conviction rate even under PMLA?
It's not really been 15 years. I would imagine the first prosecution may have been filed in the courts in about...
Okay, I'm saying the time the law has existed.
Not too many cases would have resulted in finality by now. But it's a strong law, and one can only hope that, you know, you get the desired result in this case also.
All right, that's a frank enough admission there. But Bishwajit Bhattacharya, if I can bring you in at this point, should India be celebrating or is it premature? And when it comes in the end to the question of money, to bringing back the 13,000 crores, we have Nirav Modi on the one hand in the United Kingdom, we have Mehul Choksi in Antigua. What about the other people in the case? There is Nirav Modi's brother, there is Purvi Modi, there are the two managers who are also sort of part of this, who are accused in the scam. Unless we get them all back together, is there still a chance that the entire case, for instance, could collapse? And so would that make any kind of celebration at this point or touting this as a diplomatic victory, would it be premature to do that?
Ankita, there is no question of any celebration. This is a time for national mourning. India has lost $2 billion. And nobody seems to be concerned, as you have rightly stated, to recover that money. To bring back X, Y, and Z does not mean to bring back those $2 billion into the coffers of Punjab National Bank, which is a state-owned entity. This is a classic case of deflecting the attention from the core issue. The situation is grim. The banking sector in India is under very severe stress and strain. Nobody is talking about recovery of money. People are talking about, we will send him to jail, doctors, lawyers, politicians,
air ambulances even,
prime ministers of foreign countries, going on making statements. What is there in making a statement? Talks do not count for anything. Parrots can do that. It is a question of taking action, disinterested performance of action in the national interest. It is high time the country enforces the national interest, and the national overriding interest is to recover those money and not glib talks, and not glib talks that this is a time for celebration.
Okay, Vivek Reddy,
we have done this. Prime Minister of Antigua has made a statement.
Respond to that. You know, are we seeing a classic case of deflection?
I am shocked.
Yes.
I am shocked. I am ashamed, I am appalled that public funds will be looted. Nobody talks about, recovering the money. People are only talking about people putting to jail and tampering with fundamental rights and human rights and liberties, which is sacrosanct under India's constitution. Let us recover the money. Let us not mislead. Let us not mislead the nation.
Okay,
let us
Vivek,
not
I want Vivek Reddy to respond to that. That's a very strong indictment from the former Additional Solicitor General. Vivek Reddy, this is being described as deflection, that we're not addressing the core issue. The core issue is the money. Until and unless the money can be brought back, everything else is moot. How do you respond?
Well, I think we are at step 1 and 2 of this entire investigation, and we still have to reach step 10. Perhaps whenever we reach step 10, that is when we will have the entire monies back in the kitty. And the government of India, let me tell you, has filed a charge sheet through the CBI. This is number 1. Has issued a red corner notice, and also declared him a fugitive offender. Has chased him up to Antigua, has engaged him in litigations, and is trying
Vivek
to bring
Reddy,
him back.
Vivek Reddy, there are
all
those
these
who
efforts
would argue,
are for what?
You know,
these
why did it get to that stage?
Are to recover money.
We're talking about extradition,
these efforts
which is
are
a
apparently
long and complex and complicated process
why.
Already. Why were these
Ankita,
people allowed to flee?
Hold on.
You know, you have made
please
this point
listen.
On countless shows that we have done on this before,
please
that
listen.
All of this began in the Congress time. If indeed it had begun
so
long ago, why
no,
did it
no.
take the banks so long to realize that
no,
they were
no,
being defrauded of 13,000 crores? Why are we talking in hindsight? No, no, why are we talking about extradition?
You are shifting the targets. You are shifting the targets, Ankita. The question is, how are we going to get the money? And well, this is the a prosecution has been launched. Kindly read the Economic Offenders Act, the Fugitive Economic Offenders Act.
But
the Act
that
spells out the mechanism by which
is the
money can be brought back.
Is that the magic wand that will solve everything?
Who brought in the Act? Who brought in the Act? It was the Indian government which created a special legislation for people like Mehul Choksi.
Okay, Vishwajit Bhattacharya,
like
come in on this.
And Lalit Modi's,
Vivek Reddy would have us believe that
back.
The Economic Offenders Act is going to be
and
the one-stop charm that
Mr.
will not only bring all these fugitives back to justice, but will also help India recover its lost crores.
You see, today what has happened, the Prime Minister of Antigua has made a statement. And that statement is, after the gentleman concerned, I don't want to name anyone, exhausts all his legal remedies, the emphasis is on all, then he will be extradited. As if the extradition of a human being is the end in itself. You see, the question again, perhaps I shall be repeating.
Yes.
It's time in our country, let us not only come for only optics and only for sales talks. We have had enough of talks. We have had enough of sales talks. We have done this, I have done this, he has done this, this government has done, that government has done. All governments are equally responsible. This Punjab National Bank fraud has been going on from last government to this government. It's 50-50 share by the both the governments.
Yes.
So therefore, my overriding concern is India's economic resurgence is being held back by these sales and optics talks. And people have been engaged and hired only to talk.
Okay.
We have
okay.
done this,
okay.
we have done
okay.
that,
okay.
others
okay.
have not done anything.
We come back to the point of deflection, Vivek Reddy.
So this must stop.
Yes.
Mr. Bhattacharya.
This must stop the situation.
The people
the
of India
economic
have
situation of India continues
you
to be grim until and unless the economy is taken the bull by
the
horn.
Okay.
I think India's potential to be a superpower will be impeded.
Sales and optics talk.
All right. India's economic resurgence is going to stop. Okay, Vivek Reddy. May I get a word in over here? Even in the Vijay Mallya case, the Enforcement Directorate attached his properties, had auctions, but we were not even able to get back even 50% of the amount that was lost. My point is, you're also talking about in the case of Nirav Modi and Mehul Choksi, a few properties here and there, a few paintings, a few valuables. But at the end of the day, I come back to this point about money. And we still haven't heard any kind of concrete plan about how this money is going to be recovered. If that doesn't happen, why should the citizens of India not feel cheated at this point, regardless of the extradition? If it happens, you know, again, we're jumping the gun. It's a long and complex process. We haven't even got to the point where his citizenship has been formally revoked.
If the money is not recovered, highest heads must roll.
Which are these heads, Mr. Bhattacharya?
Well, let me tell you one thing.
Let
me tell you one thing, Ankita, that allow the process to be complete and then pass your judgment. That is a simple thing. Why is Mr. Bhattacharya pressing panic buttons, and why is he painting a very negative picture about the recoveries even before the process is yet to complete? I think it is very unjust on the part of Mr. Bhattacharya to say this is all stunt and this is all optics. Mr. Bhattacharya, please remember that you are extraditing a person who is in a foreign country, and look at all the measures that have been taken by this government to extradite him. There is a legal team out there that is aggressively pursuing to bring him back to India, and you are saying this is optics. How irresponsible it could be. And due to the diplomatic victory of this country, the Prime Minister of Antigua realizes that he is a criminal, And he says, yes, he should be brought back to India.
Okay, Vivek Reddy, may I ask a follow-up question?
Well, this sort of a campaign of lies that was taken to the people of India has been answered by the people of India.
Even if we accept your point, Mr. Reddy, that this is indeed a very big diplomatic victory and we will manage to bring Mehul Choksi back, you don't have all the people accused back at the same time. They have all scattered. They're in different countries. Nirav Modi and Mehul Choksi are the... the faces of this fraud. We might in fact bring them back. You have Mr. Nirav Modi's brother, you have his niece, you have two managers of the bank, two managers who are also part of the case. If you don't manage to bring them back together, you have a case that can still stand a chance of completely collapsing.
Now, all of them will be brought in. Measures are taken to bring all of them in. But we are here talking about, when we talk about Mehul Choksi and Nirav Modi, we are talking about the linchpins. And if you have the linchpins,
then you are admitting it's about the optics.
I think you will get the whole story out. You will be able to detect all the money and you will be able to, it is not about the optics. It is hard effort in order to realize. Let me tell you one more thing, Ankita. And I like to ask Mr. Bhattacharya also. There have been previous instances of foreigners, the chief of Bhopal gas tragedy, who ran away from India, and India never did anything under the Congress regime to bring him back. And there was a similar instance of Bofors scandal. Rastogi went away to Italy and thereafter to Chile, and he disappeared. They allowed him to die. They did nothing. But our government has passed the Fugitive Economic Offenders Bill.
Surely we can't.
That bill was specially made out in order to bring these people back. So, this is where you find the difference in approach.
Surely we can't conflate serious crimes with financial
fraud. Which was under a chalta hai sentiment.
Okay. I want to bring in one little more thing into the equation. We've been hearing how India is promising that it will provide sort of three-star facilities for Vijay Mallya in jail as and when he is in fact extradited, because the British courts want that. Now we are hearing that an air ambulance could be sent in order to get Mehul Choksi back, because he is talking about his medical problems and that is something that is going to be considered also. So, isn't this really throwing good money after bad? Why are we wasting more public funds? Atul Verma, if you would like to come in on this.
Well, see, as I said before, this is a very long drawn process, and from an investigating agency's point of view,
yes,
I would disagree with Mr. Bhattacharya. You surely want to get that person also in, as well as want to go after the money. Both the things have to go on simultaneously, and both the things sustain each other.
But can we begin to go after the money at all before he is brought back to the country? Or is that the necessary prerequisite before that process can even begin?
I would imagine that it has been simultaneously going on. It should be. Because tracing money is not such an easy job. It should be going on. Nothing stops you from doing that until he is brought in. But something like a custodial interrogation is an integral part of investigation, and that helps in both. Coming back to the ambulance part, see, you have to anticipate what are the issues that he is going to raise. They've already raised, and typically a fugitive would raise issues like human rights, issues like conditions in the jail, and different countries from where you're trying to extradite will have different laws.
Okay.
So going by that, here I think a medical issue has already been raised. So they would like to counter that in whatever way possible.
Right.
And which will not always be easy.
Okay. And we can promise sort of three-star jail facilities and air ambulances in order to counter all of these, just in our efforts to bring them back. That is a fair utilization of public funds.
Depends on what that country wants.
All right. Very quick last comments, Vishwajit Bhattacharya, before I wrap this up. If there is one message to take away from how this has been handled, what would it be?
You see, this is an economic issue of the country. I don't know why the Congress and BJP and all these things should be brought in. I don't have to defend any party like my learned friend may have to defend. I think all parties are equally to be blamed. Number two, the Enforcement Directorate and the Central Bureau of Investigation, they have not quite enjoyed the highest reputation. So let's also recognize the fact that it is not in the domain of Central Bureau of Investigation, of Enforcement Directorate, to make noises. That way the money does not get recovered at all. I think we should focus on the economics of the country and forget Congress, BJP mudslinging, which my learned friend has stated. And I think let us collectively work for India's economic resurgence, for the deprived have-nots of the country, and not make it a political issue.
All right, wise words.
I really deprecate.
Yes.
My panelists who make it a political issue.
Okay, fair
it
enough.
It is an economic issue of the country.
All right.
For the poor
sure,
of the country.
I'm sure that's something we can all agree
on. And for
on.
India's strength.
I'm sure that's something we can all agree on. We'll leave it at that for the moment, as everyone is admitting
that
at this point.
Mr. Bhattacharya?
It's a long process still.
That
it's not over.
Happening.
It's not over. We're going to be talking about this for some time to come. Thank you all for joining us on this discussion tonight.